What exactly does it mean to focus on the social communicative function of imitation?
Hi, I'm Dr. Megan, and I guide people in growing, learning, and fostering connection and curiosity.
We've been talking lately about some important aspects for teaching imitation, especially to autistic children. And I've had a few questions about what exactly does it mean to focus on imitation from a social communicative function? Can you provide some examples? How do we collect data on this? So I wanted to take a minute to go through some answers to those questions, and I will also be sharing a few video examples as well.
So today I just wanted to kind of give a little bit more detail about what exactly it means to look at the social communicative function of imitation. And in this video, I'm going to share a short clip at the end that I found with my son. We weren't specifically working on imitation, but I just want to show it as an example of when we're looking at interactions that little ones are having with their parents or their grandparents in this case, we see this happening all of the time. So this is how naturalistic it is for imitation to have a social communicative function. Yet for some reason, within behavior analysis and other teaching, like there's other fields that do this as well, this operant procedure that's referred to as do this is what has kind of taken over as the way that many, many people focus on teaching imitation. Even though it's not natural at all, it doesn't always generalize, and it definitely does not connect with the social communicative function of imitation. If this is something you're really interested in, I highly recommend searching on Google Scholar for reciprocal imitation training. I'll do a whole like separate video on why I know so much about this, but if you want any of my resources, feel free to DM me and I'll send you information. We also have like courses and stuff where I go over this as well. Anyway, getting into it, when we're working on imitation as a social communicative function, you're starting with just imitating the child. So you imitate the sounds they make, any facial expressions, gestures, anything safe that they're doing. Even if it's not functional play, like even if it's play that you don't understand, they're spinning in circles, they're jumping up and down, they're waving paper in front of their face. Whatever it is, you just imitate it. And just that one first step alone, having the child see you do what they're doing, immediately will build a much stronger connection. There's just something that happens for us as humans. When we see people doing what we're doing, we connect more with one another. And this has been demonstrated in studies both with autism and without, like when looking at various diagnoses or typical development, this social communicative function of imitation is well established.
So like I said, I'm gonna put in a little video clip with my son and show you all what exactly I'm talking about. It's a really quick example with him and my mom when he was just about to turn one, and he starts randomly making this new sign for hat that's very similar to the sign he was doing for ball when they're having this back and forth exchange. So my mom imitates that, and then they just have this really nice social interaction and shared enjoyment around his communication with the hat. She's also echoing the sounds that he's making as well. And I just want you to see like how natural and flowing this is, and think about the way that you're currently teaching imitation, and if it looks anything like this. If it does, that's absolutely amazing. If it doesn't, I'm not surprised, because that's not how we're trained to work on imitation. If this is something that you want to continue to learn more about, please give me a follow. And again, we'll be diving in more with more examples and more stepping out what it looks like once you start imitating the child. What are the next steps?
Hat. Oh, thank you. Yeah, hat. Hat. Hat.